Hi there, Malcolm here with my 144th BookTube video, and today I'll be bringing you February's wrap-up. Got 9 books to get through, so let's get cracking. First up is my book of the month, Full Moon by Jim Butcher, book 2 of the Harry Dresden Files. I've done a separate video on this, so if you want to know what I thought of that, then click on the link below. And once I finished that, I then read The Throwback by Tom Sharp. This was a reread and a comedic farce surrounding a wealthy landowner, his illegitimate grandson, and a mother and daughter they meet on a cruise who they subsequently marry, and the mother's attempt to get hold of the money. To be honest, the plot is rather loose and wavery, but that's not what works in these books. The characters are ridiculous, caricatures, going through increasingly unlikely scenarios, from the sublime to the macabre, full of completely over-the-top situations, from blowing up housing estates to getting rid of taxmen with a flood. I wouldn't say it's Tom Sharp's greatest book, it was still a hell of a lot of fun. Buy it. After that, I then read One of the Adventures of Tintin by Hergé. Tintin goes on an innocuous cruise and is soon embroiled in a mystery, which is so mysterious he doesn't know what the mystery is for so long. Something to do with some cigars. And indeed, it's not until right at the end, literally the last page, that we actually find out what the mystery is and what is it about these cigars. But because he stumbled on this mystery, people tried to kill him. He gets out of these situations in impossible and ridiculous ways. For example, he survives a firing squad due to the fact that all the bullets have been replaced by blanks. I've read this one many, many times. Booktastic. And then it's on to Sphere by Michael Crichton. This comes a reread, and it follows an astrophysicist, a biologist, a mathematician, and a psychologist as they're conscripted by some secret agency, taken to the middle of the Pacific Ocean, taken down to the bottom of the Pacific Ocean to investigate a UFO, or an unidentified crashed object anyway. And inside this crashed object, they find a large sphere, and then things start going a bit odd. Now, this one's a bit of a psychological thriller that I think works really well. This has been made into a film, also called Sphere, starring Dustin Hoffman, Sharon Stone and Samuel Jackson, which, although stuck pretty close to the book, there are a number of quite interesting differences. But I think having knowledge of the film does help with enjoying the book. The two do complement each other very nicely, even though they are quite different in places. Now, it's a bit of a slow burn. There's quite a period of time at the beginning of the book where you don't know what's going on. You follow the psychologist as he's brought to this place. No one's telling him anything. He meets his team and they don't know what's going on. And they get taken down underneath the ocean. They still don't know what's going on. And it's not until they're underwater seeing this object sitting at the seabed do they start getting an idea that there's something more going on here. And more questions. Although some members do come to the answer pretty quickly, they keep that to themselves. And so as a reader, you don't know unless you worked it out yourself. Originally published in 1987, this is one of Michael Crichton's better aged books. Jurassic Park is still fantastic, but when you come up to anything to do with computers, it has dated a lot. Congo I really like, but again, that one's dated massively in certain technological ways. This one could have been written today. It doesn't feel like it's aged at all. So if you haven't read Sphere, give it a shot. If you haven't seen the film, go find it. I really enjoy it. And I will say this book is booktastic. Obviously it works for me. And after that, I then read The Blue Lotus, another Adventures of Tintin by Hergé. And this one, he travels to China as a direct result of the events in Cigars of the Pharaoh. And this was my first read. Having read Cigars of the Pharaoh so many times, it's quite enjoyable to read the sequel to it. It even starts in India, where we left Tintin at the end of the previous book. And unlike Hergé's attempts at Tintin in America and Tintin in the Congo, he's actually made an effort to get the culture of the people of the country he set the story in a much better representation. One could argue that the caricature of the Japanese character in it is perhaps less than perfect, but I suppose it was an effort to differentiate him from the Chinese people around him. But a really interesting story, and one that Tintin is actually actively involved in rather than just falls in, like with many other adventures. And a nice conclusion to The Cigars of the Pharaoh. Booktastic. And then we move on to Point Horror April Fools by Richie Tankersley-Cusick. I'd previously read Trick or Treat by the same author, which I really enjoyed, so I was looking forward to seeing another story by this one, and can say I was greatly disappointed. The story starts off with a car accident. Well, it's not really a car accident, it's a car misadventure, really, where three friends are involved in pushing another car off of the road and bursting into flames, and then not helping. Or rather, the main character, Belinda, who was in the back seat at the time, who obviously had nothing to do with causing the accident, she's the one that gets out to try and lend a hand, but her two friends stop her. And what follows is a really irritating story when her tutoring skills are hired out to a car crash victim Yes, it's the same one. I don't know, it's just certain decisions were made or not made. The characters kind of got what they deserved. Not so much Belinda, because she was kind of press-ganged into keeping Stumm. Yeah, it could put it down to lack of self-confidence or self-esteem. Now, I can understand why she was pressurised into it. But her two friends are absolutely awful, and it's a case of, well, why is she even friends with these idiots? The end was a huge pickup, though. That was quite exciting. A nice twist in there. And so I'd say the ending was quite satisfying, but I nearly gave up with it. I was really irritated through so much of this story. Worth reading, I suppose. After one point to the next, I then read Mother's Helper by A. Bates. Much better story, this one. It follows a young nanny, and she's hired to a private island, to a private condo, to look after a toddler while mum is busy doing whatever she's busy doing in town. You know, and as long as this child is well fed and put to bed, she can enjoy just lounging out in the sun and working on her tan. Bit of a cushy number, she's getting well paid for it. It's a bit isolated for her liking, but everything's going well. Until some mysterious chap turns up, apparently out of the blue, and then some weird scenarios happen. You know, suddenly he feels too secluded. There's something going on with the mum. There's an awful lot we don't know what's going on, which could be irritating, but it wasn't. It was well played out. I enjoyed how it all unravelled and how the story progressed. And a pretty good twist at the end as well. Worth buying. And then I read The Black Island, another Tintin. And this one, he really is thrown into the middle of something. He's just minding his own business, walking along the road, when he sees a plane crash. He wanders over to say, you know, can I help? And he gets shot for his efforts. So by the end of page one, he's lying unconscious on the floor, having been shot. So that's a cracking start. And of course, he finds himself embroiled in another mystery. He doesn't know what it is. He does find out a bit quicker than usual. There's no particularly ridiculous escapes this time, apart from surviving being shot. Tis but a scratch, it turned out to be. Another book I've read many, many times and have got a lot of love for. Very satisfying story, very satisfying ending. Booktastic. And then finally, it was the first reading of King Ottoku's Scepter, a book I'd been long and curious about since Explorers on the Moon, where a certain villain reappears, and it says, you know, see King Ottoku's Scepter to find out more about this character. So, oh, it's going to be all about this character. He's barely in it. The Black Island introduces another recurring villain, but he's more significant in both books. This one, the character is, he's in a couple of pages and that's it. So I wouldn't exactly say he's a memorable character to bring back for a future adventure. But anyway, in this one, Tintin's out for a walk and finds himself in another adventure. The man should stop going out his front door, I tell you. And he sits on a park bench and finds a briefcase just left there, and he returns it to the owner. Turns out there's a plot to steal the scepter from the King of Sildavia, and it's up to Tintin to foil this plot. So another mystery to solve. And one revelation Tintin really should have seen much sooner rather than just completely dismissing it outright. Basically, he meets a character, he then phones the character later on and he's apparently attacked. And the next time he meets a character, he's acting completely different and can see better. But we just brush that off and pretend that didn't happen. And the insane death-defying escape this time is he is dropped out of a flying plane and lands safely in a haystack being pulled by a cart. As you do. I don't have nostalgia behind this one. Buy it. So there you go, 9 books and a pretty successful time of it. I was a little bit disappointed with one of the point horrors, particularly as I really enjoyed the other story by the same author. It wasn't terrible, it just really irritated me. Quite a lot of rereads as well. Not a bad month though. So how was your reading in February? Any surprises there, like disappointments or exceeded expectations? Comments down below, please. But as usual, if you have nothing nice to say, then please keep it to yourself. Thank you, and until next time. See you later.